Blackstone Publishing presents This Is Not For You, An Activist's Journey of Resistance and Resilience by Richard Brown with Brian Benson. This book is read by Emmett Wheatfall with a foreword and afterword read by Richard Brown.
To my parents, Agnes and Richard Brown, who could see in the dark.
Foreword. It's hard to say exactly when this book began, but if I had to choose a moment, I think I'd point to the day 4 or 5 years ago when a teenager who had just seen me give a speech to families of new police, a speech about cops' work and their well-being and their responsibility to take care of themselves so they can do right by us civilians, came up to me and asked, "How do I do what you do?" I don't remember what I said. All I know is I didn't answer his question. I couldn't. And that bothered me. It bothered me because I love that the boy asked what he asked. And I wanted nothing more than to help him learn to walk the path I've walked. And I just didn't know how to. My first thought when I sat down to think about this was that I should probably make a checklist, a how-to. I figured, thanks to 20 years of military training, that I ought to create some sort of structured learning. But when I tried to do that, I couldn't make it work. I couldn't fit my life into checkboxes. So before long, I scrapped the how-to, and I started thinking bigger. For years, people who knew me have been saying I ought to write a book. Whenever I told them the stories of my life, and I did often, they'd say, "Richard, you really ought to write that down." Well, I'd always taken that as mere flattery. And anyway, I was no writer, never had been. But the more I thought about a book, the more I liked the idea. And so I decided I'd try and find a writer, find someone who'd help me write whatever it was I needed to write. I looked for a while, asked around, brought up my plans as often as I could. And finally, after about a year, a conversation I was having brought Brian Benson into my life. At that point, all I knew about Brian was he was a writer and he worked with other writers. I invited him to lunch. On a Friday in January, we met up at a Jordanian restaurant and we talked. For 3 hours, we talked. I don't think either of us knew it yet. But on that day, at that table, a journey and a friendship began. We met again, the next Friday, and the next, and so on. I'd talk, and Brian would listen and ask questions. And though some of his questions felt more, way more, than what was needed for the thing I thought I wanted to write, I liked answering them. In doing so, I got to sort of relive my life. The more I did this, the more I came to see how my past shaped what I'd done and who I'd become. And at some point, it became clear to me that I couldn't just write a how-to or a checklist, because that wasn't how I'd learned. I'd learned from listening to others, from seeing what they had done, and making my own meaning. I wanted to give other people, people like that teenager, the chance to do the same. So I wrote this book, a memoir. I wrote this memoir because I want to answer the teenager's questions. I wrote it because I wanted to show him and anyone else who cares to listen what it looks like when a person decides something is important, then decides to do something about it and keep on doing something. I wrote it because activism, especially activism around police, and especially activism around the rift between police and Black people, is slow, painful, mostly thankless work, and it's difficult to get folks to want to sign up. And the only way I've ever succeeded in doing so is by telling stories about the work I do, stories about the things I've learned and gained from it, stories like the one you're about to read. I wasn't born an activist, not even close. I was a loudmouth kid, then a loudmouth adult, and never wanted to get too involved in much.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.